and that narrate or talk about the impossible or mourning of women and men in Vietnam after what they call the American War. And then you started, as I said, writing this feature in 2008, and it took very much time to finance it, and then, it will be actually my first question afterwards, but your method, your working method changed a lot from the moment you wrote the script, the moment you went to Morocco, the moment you met the characters, so we'll go back to that. So thank you again for being here. Marianne, so I should pronounce the French way, Marianne Hirsch, yes. So I think everybody knows you here and beyond the borders of Colombia, of course, but I'll just let me say a few things. So you're William Peter Trent Professor of English and Comparative Literature here at Colombia, but you're also the director of the Institute for Research on Women, Gender and Sexuality. You are one of the founders of Columbia Center for the Study of Social Difference, which is of course a topic of course that we can tackle, and of its global initiative Women Creating Change. And among your many published books, you have written The Generation of Past Memory, Writing a Visual Culture After the Holocaust, and Writer Return, that is Foreign Politics and the Politics of Memory. So thank you again for being here. And Bachir Diagne is Professor of French and Chair of the French and Romance and Literature Department in Colombia. You also teach philosophy, and you also taught philosophy in Senegal, in Dakar, the Cheikh Anta Diop University before that. And well, among your numerous books, we can mention Personne postcoloniale, L'élan vital dans la pensée de Sandor et de Mohamed Iqbal. Et également, je voulais signaler Comment philosopher en islam, that was published in 2013. So, my first question will go to Boris, because I would like him to tell us more about how he conceived and wrote the script, how he spent time in Morocco, how he found his characters, and how actually also the script changed along the way, even during the shooting of the film.
Merci toi. The writing of this film was very long because I was very inexperienced. It's my first fiction film, first feature film. I never did any short film, so I don't do documentary film before, so it was my really first fiction writing. And it took me a lot of time, I think, because it took me a lot of time to find a story. I knew the subject, I wanted to make a film about these migrating journeys through Africa, because I read in the paper some of the migrants telling their stories, and I thought, wow, these journeys are so incredible, I want to make a film out of that. It's very basic, I'm sorry, I have no incredible story to tell yet. Then I began to work, and as we know, a good subject is not a good story, and it took me a lot of time to find my story, and to find that it would not be the story of a man, but the story of a couple. And of course it changes everything, and it changes the story, but it also changes the view that I have and that I give about this subject, this migration road. I'll try to answer a little bit more than Nora. And stop me if I talk too much. I wrote my script in my room in France. I wrote for 2 years or 3 years, I don't remember, in France, and I financed the film with this script. And then I went to Morocco just to prepare the film, because in a fiction film process, you go to the locations after you have finished your script, and only to find the locations where you have written one scene, you just find the location where you will shoot the scene. Or if you have to do some casting for secondary parts and things like that. But Maybe because I had this documentary experience before. Of course, when I arrived in Morocco, it was impossible for me to stick to this program. And I began to make a lot of research about what I could see in Morocco, about all these migrant communities. And it changed a lot in my comprehension, in my understanding of this world. In fact, it changed two things. First, I discovered the existence of what they call the ghettos. I read a little bit about it, because I read a lot in France, all the documents, a lot of books, articles, NGO reports, everything I could find. And sometimes they mentioned the ghettos, but yes, like with the marginalia, it was not something important. And when I went there, I found that the ghetto was not something, it was the essential part of this this world. It was the, yes, it was essential to understand how they lived on the journey. And I understood that the ghetto was national. You have a Cameroonian ghetto, a Nigerian ghetto. In each city of Algeria, you have a ghetto for each nationality, and sometimes for each ethnic group. For example, Nigerians have four major ethnic groups in the migration, and sometimes they have four ghettos because they don't, they have difficulties between them. And when I understood that, and that these ghettos were very organized with what they call government, with a chairman, with laws, with what they call fuck-up. Fuck-up is everything you can do against the law of the ghetto. And when I understood how important it was in the life of the migrants in their journeys, I thought that it should be in the script. And so I understood also that the story of this couple should be the story of a man and a woman from two different nationalities. And it would be more interesting if I took an Anglophone and a Francophone, because they are more far away. And if I took a Nigerian girl, it would be even more interesting, because the Nigerians are what the other call the most dangerous in the world. Everybody feared the Nigerians. So, in fact, I decided, because when I was writing in France, the question of the nationality didn't seem important to me. In fact, each version, they had a different nationality, because it had no meaning for me. But when I was on the field, I understood exactly what would be involved. So that was my first discovery, the ghetto reality. And second, it was already the story of a couple and the problems with the women. But you know, it's different to read in a book and to stand in front of the person. And I met a lot of women. I'm sorry, I'm too long.
It's okay, but I have a question for Marianne, but I think it's really interesting to
understand your question. Yeah, I finished with this. I met a lot of women from Cameroon, from Congo, from Nigeria, who went on this road. And so I met them in Morocco. So Morocco is the end of the road. And for me, this meeting were very moving. I thought it was so terrible for this woman, for all these women. You know, a lot of times I ask the men, is it more difficult for a woman or for a man? And all the men would answer, it's more difficult for the men. Why? Because a woman, she can always manage. And on the road, manage, it means always the same. It means prostitution. And in fact, I met a lot of women who had different kinds of kind of experience of prostitution. It has many forms, but a large majority of them had to suffer something of the prostitution experience. And in the end of the road, they were so deeply wounded that I thought that this is really what I have to tell. This is the story I have to tell. And not the adventure of a man, but this is the story I have to tell. And of course it changes all the perspective I could give on this migration journey.
If you go and see Fire at Sea by Rosie, which is the screen at the local center on Friday night, there's one of the protagonists is a doctor, a real doctor, in Lampedusa, Sicily, and he says that he has all the women who, and there are hundreds of thousands who arrive to Lampedusa, have been raped or have experienced assault. So, and he explains that, and as a doctor, he sees that, I mean, he's never seen the country, so it's, and I knew that, but I didn't know in such proportions. And your film, that's also why it was important to show it, shows the African journey, which is very, actually, at least by European filmmakers, rarely shown. The Mediterranean Sea journey, or the European route is shown, but not this part of the journey. Marianne, I see this film as a woman, and I find it very difficult to see. And we have long arguments also with Boris about, is it the story of a woman, is it the story of a couple? And also because Boris decided, because both of the actors who were non-professional had their personality was not to talk, to speak much. How did you read the character of Hope, the female character of Hope, as between her agency and the fact that she's in a most excruciating way a victim? How?
Well, I think she's not a simple character. I mean, she's a complex character. First of all, she's a fantastic actress. Really, this, she can convey this story, I think, in a very powerful way. And I think she's a complex character because she's not simply a victim, she's an agent. We see her drive to go. I would have liked to know more about why she left home, where in Nigeria she's from, what her background is. I mean, I feel like we know very little about her in order to kind of flesh out the character here. I was very interested in the fact that you gave us the trigger warning before the film. You told us there would be difficult scenes to see, and yes, this story of rape and prostitution is extremely difficult, but there's so many kinds of violence that are compounded in the film, and I found that the violence against women the film begins with that, and it makes it very clear that that's what the film is going to be about. But then there's so many kinds of violence that are perpetrated in these groups, and so much threat and so much vulnerability that affects the men as much as the women. And there again, I would have liked to, I was curious about what the larger frame would be, where they come from and where they're going, and the violence that awaits them across the sea as well, because we see the African against African violence that we don't, in a series that's migrating to Europe is pretty much absent in the film. So anyway, I told you more than just home, many questions, and I found it very important.
Well, Boris made the choice of not, and then I had the interview, but Boris did choose not to talk more about situations that make you real portraits.
Yeah, I just want to say two things. First, I decided not to show the beginning nor the end of the journey. You say that you were curious to know more about why she left. But in fact, it's very obvious. And when I asked the question, almost everybody answered the same. And Nigerians have a sentence that they say, we go for green on pasture. And so my feeling as a filmmaker was that it was not the most interesting thing, because we know why they leave and we don't have to explain that. And for the Europe, for me, what starts in after the arrival in Europe is it's a different story, it's a different film. So it was for me the story is really in the in between. After the crossing of the Sahara, because after the crossing of the Sahara, there are no more in black country. They arrive in these very racist countries of northern Africa. And that was the reality I wanted to depict, is a very specific reality, different from what is before, where there is violence too, and different from the violence in Europe. Of course, there is violence in Europe. And just you are right that the film depicts mainly the violence inside the community, but it begins with a rape which is committed with, by this Algerian military. And even if it's just one scene, it was very important for me that there was this one scene at the beginning, because it's a way with that I try to say, maybe it's not enough, but I try to say that all the violence that we see after is the consequence of this first violence. And of course, this violence inside the communities are the consequences of the fact that all these migrants are illegals, so they are put aside of the legal and normal society. And all the violence inside the community is just a consequence of that.
Yes, I'd like Professor Bachir to comment on this. Actually, exactly as you said, the first point of entry is violence on group and on women, but it's not only that, it's a whole system that deals with power relationships and also sets of, at the same time, rules and total absence of law. And I would like you to comment on this. It seems endless, sort of at the same time an extremely complicated hierarchy and something that is at the same time completely beside that we cannot read. And the film is always at the same time showing fake rituals, for instance, that are there to express power. And at the same time, sort of desert of any kind of, you know, when you see it, when will it end? What will there be justice at some point? It never happens.
And it is true that it has, seems that there is no reason why it would be ending. Actually, I was thinking while watching the film of a novel, actually, which seems to be developing along the same lines. The novel in question is by Marianne, the third part of Trois Femmes Puissantes, the book on. And the third femme puissante is precisely someone who undertakes the journey also of immigration. In this case, we have the beginning, and just like the movie we've seen, the choice is to concentrate on the internal violence. It's fascinating to see that immigrants are, in some respect, an indistinct mass of and but they never form a community. You have, as you say, not only this division into ghettos, it is amazing that somehow it follows the lines of nationalities. When you mentioned the fact that Nigerians would be divided into three or four, it somehow makes more sense, because language, I would expect, is the most important thing. You emigrate, you are living, you have to speak the same language. So the grouping people by the language they speak seem to be relevant. This is why somehow I'm wondering, and this was the question I wanted to ask Boris, why is it such a big deal that the woman is actually Nigerian and he's Cameroonian? In other words, I can understand this regrouping according to languages spoken, etc., etc., but then everybody just sees, points towards the wife and say, you are bringing a Nigerian wife into into this community and this was the very important. But the concentration on the violence before, before crossing Europe, putting the focus, seems to be for reasons that have to do probably with the law of conflict, something more attractive. And I was fascinated by the fact that Marianne also was attracted by that. In her case, I mean, here you have a beautiful love story, but in the case of Marianne, it is a story of betrayal. The man leaves after she became a prostitute in the same way, and he took all the money and left, and she's the one who dies, not in the sea, or next to the sea, but on the fences.
Well, this also seems to me to be a story about multiple betrayals all the time, and in fact, I mean, the fact that she leaves at the end without him, I mean, there's a question of betrayal, even at the end of this film as well, always selling the baby and, you know, the ways that they're betrayed by every contract they entered into is a betrayal, right? And so I think it's very related.
Your question is about why is it so important that she is Nigerian. It's a question of money. A woman on the road means money. So why is it a problem that you bring a Nigerian woman here? That if you bring a Nigerian woman in the Cameroonian ghetto, it means that the Nigerian ghetto will be losing a woman, which means money. So they will be angry, and it would be war. And sometimes it happens that you have some wars between ghettos in Tamagrasset or in Magnia. Magnia is the border city between Algeria and Morocco. Or in, I don't remember the name, on the border city between Mali and Algeria, you also have big ghettos. And sometimes I heard of a war there. Between Cameroon and Nigeria. So the problem is money, it's always money. And it was very important for me in the film to try to talk a lot about money, because I think that's what people are discussing the most in these cases. So the even if it's a kind of love story, between Hope and Léonard, they never talk about feelings, they talk together about money. Because that's the problem, how to get to the next step, how to survive, how to make it. But maybe sometimes through the money, some other feelings can find a way.
And you were saying that the script changed a lot once you were in Morocco, and indeed you found that you spent many months with the person in charge of the casting, and I'd like you maybe to give us some advice on the process of how you chose to work with Justin Wong and how you worked during the shooting. And there are some scenes specifically that are completely documentary, others that you stayed free that we wrote together, and it's a whole very mobile process. That
you
created with the actors?
Yes, I decided that I would make this film with an entirely non-professional actors, and this is probably the main decision in the making of this film. Because when you decide to work with non-professional actors, it affects all the process. I took this decision for many reasons, but mainly because when I see black actors in France who have African origins, and when they are talking in French, and they had to talk in French in my film, I never believe they are African. I know they are French. I know they live in Paris. I recognize them immediately. And, well, that's good news. It means that integration works. But I did a little bit of casting in France just to test it, to see was it possible or not? And well, I've been in several countries in Africa, and when I met them, I had the feeling they are they're really French, they're really Parisian. And sometimes I see so-called African films, but with Parisian casting, and I don't believe it. And first of all, because of the language, the way people speak French in Cameroon or in Ivory Coast or in Congo, it's not the same French that you speak in Paris. And it's a beautiful French, I love it. And I want it to have this in my film. So I decided to make the casting with non-professional actors all in Morocco to save something of the of this background. Also because me, I'm outside, I mean, I'm a foreigner, I'm not an African migrant, so even if I make a lot of research, if I make a lot of documentation work, I will never know enough. So I thought that there are things that you cannot imagine just because you read a book or because you made 10 interviews. You cannot know exactly how people talk to them together in the ghetto, how you talk with the chairman, which words you will use, all these things. What's the gesture? So I made this casting in Morocco inside of the communities, and as I decided that I would have a Nigerian woman and a Cameroonian man, I made two separated casting, one inside Cameroonian community and one inside Nigerian community. And I met a lot of people in their places, many places, in the houses, in the common houses. And for the Cameroonian, it was hard work, but it was nothing impossible. But for the Nigerian, it was really more difficult. First, because the Nigerians are more organized, and a lot of bandits among them. I talk of the migration only, I'm not talking about Nigeria in general. And second, because I was looking for a woman, and everybody told me the women are not free, you cannot meet them. So I had to find my way, this was very difficult. And first I tried to work with, I should call them pimps. So I met the pimps and I gave them some money so that they could introduce me their girls and bring them to the cafe so that I could talk with them. But it was very difficult to work like that. I didn't like it so much, you can imagine. And it was a lot of pain and little results. So then I had the idea that even if the women are imprisoned, they go out when they have to go to church. So I began to work with the pastors, and this was very efficient. So every Sunday I would go to church, even not to the Rabat Cathedral, of course, but to a Nigerian church, different every Sunday. And with that I met a lot of women. And finally, I made a lot of connections, and I knew a lot of people of the community, and I found who were the important person of this community, who were the powerful persons, and finally I met endurance like that. But it was a long process. But what was interesting for me is that during this casting process, I also learned a lot. So it was very useful for me for the rewriting of my script. And I used this time also like that.
I find it hard to understand exactly how many weeks or months pass, and I was wondering what was your reading of that journey, the time of the film. I personally, the pregnancy has helped me, but it's as the film is at the same time constructed on an emergency, urgence, and something that there's no beginning and no end. It's exactly like the characters have no really beginning, not really an end. was wondering what were your emotions and analysis.
It goes on a very fast, pace at first, and it makes you appreciate the moment when they seem to be taking their time. Actually, the kind of love story when he finds out that he is truly attracted to her and being protective of her, etc. I like that moment because the movie seems to be taking its time, and then afterwards it goes very fast again. I cannot truly understand why, having decided not to try fences, they go to the Nigerian chairman. In that case, it was somehow too fast for me. I could not figure out the logic of going to the chairman.
The logic is that the Nigerian chairman is the only one who has the power to send them to Europe, because he's the one who has the connection. So it's kind of renunciation, they renounce to their freedom to go to the place where they will be slaves, but they will have a chance to go to Europe. That's the idea. But I agree with you, so it's too short and too fast.
One last question to Marianne, maybe we could leave the audience ask questions and share comments. It seems that some part of the audience, the film was also shown enough, so we can talk also about the reception in France, the reception of the film in Cameroon, in Africa, and elsewhere. But some spectators said that there was enough hope, or that it was difficult to represent such a journey without any with no opening, no hope, or and show so much violence. You had actually comments about that. Actually, it's more violence than the other film. And I was wondering if you would share that feeling or not share it.
Well, the film is bleak, and I guess my response had to do with the balance between the love story and the migration story. I mean, there's something in the moment that you cite, which is the moment in the river where they really meet for the first time, which seems to be somewhat of a timeout from the journey, like a stop. And of course, it's a very archetypal baptism. You know, it has many resonances. I mean, there's something that happens in that moment and that then continues in the relationship that somehow rises above the violence and the hopelessness of the migration story. And I wonder if that gives us too much, if it's maybe too redemptive, given the reality that you're actually depicting in the film. There's more. I mean, there's really the beauty of the film itself. I mean, the visual beauty, and I think the music, which is also very well chosen and also very good. So I think there's a lot there that lifts the film above the hopelessness of the narrative of the story there. So I think it's a question of balance for me.
Thank you very much. So Boris Lojkine, Bachir, and Marianne are there to answer your questions. Well, I said yes. Would you like a microphone or can you?
Excuse me?
Would you like a microphone?
I'm wondering, are they all the actors undocumented in Morocco? Who, I mean, because they're not.
Are they still in Morocco? You are asking.
I mean, but they're basically all I mean, they're all the people who are migrating, right? In truth.
Yes.
So, but yes. They were working legally with you somehow in this subterranean. I don't know.
Okay.
How does that work?
Are there people from police here? Or can I answer truly to the question? Okay, I will answer truly to the question. No, they are illegals, all of them. And I had no choice because inside these migrating communities, everybody is illegal. So they are illegals, and to hire them, I went to the black market and I bought two passports from a Nigerian smuggler. And and for because we shooting, you have to insure it, and the insurance company want a passport number. They had no passport. I mean, when I met Justin, I think he had two or three passports, but none of them was true. I mean, none of them was his real name and real nationality. So I got two more for him, and two more for her too. That's how we did putting that.
Any of them arrive in Europe? Do you know?
No. In Morocco, you have a lot of people who are migrants, but it's like the end of the road because it's difficult to go from, let's say, Central Africa to Morocco. It's difficult, but it's not impossible, and it's cheap. With let's say $150, you can make it. And if you are lucky, you can make it in 2 weeks. If you are not lucky, you can make it in 2 years. Depends. But it's not impossible. But then, when they arrive in Morocco, they are stopped there because you have either the fence, which is very dangerous and difficult to cross, or the sea, and the sea is not for free. You have to pay. You have to pay €1,300. So a lot of them are stuck there. So what we call migrants, some of them are in Morocco, have been in Morocco for 10 years. Some of them are just here for 2 weeks, but some of them have been there for 10 years. And if the question is where they are now, Endurance, she's still in Morocco, but she doesn't want anymore to go to Europe. And she has a Nigerian husband, who I think is a good husband, but who also was chairman for a time. And I visited his ghetto after the shooting of this film in the border of Algeria and Morocco. I stayed in the ghetto. It was very interesting, but a little bit crazy. But I tell this another time. And Justin, after the shooting, he went back to Cameroon, and I helped him settle down back in Cameroon. So I bought I raised a little bit of some money for him, and we bought some machines to work with the wood.
So we didn't get awards from Tübingen.
She gets some money from Tübingen that I gave her, but at that time her husband was chairman, so she preferred to stay in Morocco. And then I think she was afraid of going, because if you have the money, you have to take a boat and you risk your life. And she has a son who is now 3 years old. So you have to risk your life and the life of your child. And I always say, personally, I don't recommend it. Also because I know that after arriving in Europe, it's not easy. So Justin is back in Cameroon. Endurance is still in Casablanca, in Morocco, but she doesn't want anymore to go to Europe. And I think she wants to do the same that Justin. She'd like to open a little business in Nigeria. And if she does so, I will try to help her. I get it for her.
Yeah. So
for
the speech.
I just had a question about the chairman themselves. Do they still guard the hope of ever reaching Europe? Or are they more in the mindset of being set up in a place of really creating a business?
It depends, but it's true that usually a chairman is an ex-migrant, and sometime after because it's only for time, it depends, 6 months or 1 year, and when you finish your time, it's finished. So a lot of them, after finishing, they make some money because they make some business with the position, and a lot of them, they use this money to pay the end of the travel. But some of them, they also find that it's a good business, so they finish their position, and after that another chairman comes, but after 1 year they begin, they do it in another city, and there is like a network like this. So it depends.
Okay, thank you. for you as she went to Morocco and then you like got to know more about the communities there? Because I remember the scene when Hope was fed the chicken cod. Like, did you have that plan, or was that something that got inspired?
This scene, I had planned it before because I read this in books. In fact, this voodoo ceremony is very common. There is one thing that is wrong in the film, I have to say, I have to admit, it's that you never do that in Morocco. But usually you do this in the beginning of the journey, before the journey begins, back in Nigeria, you do this voodoo ceremony because you want the women to work for you in Europe, and you don't want them to go when they will be in Europe. So almost every Nigerian woman who are brought on this road, they do this ceremony before. So I had this idea before, maybe not the words, but the idea was there. The main change in the script was that the character of the woman took more and more importance in the film, and even in the shooting. And I know that my initial idea was to make a film about a man, but I know that now the audience will look only at the woman and will be worried about the woman, will fear for the woman, not for the man. I know.
Comment. I thought it was very clever. I don't know how you say clever in French, but it was very clever. It was very clever to put the word monopoly inside of the room. It was very clever to have that word on the wall.
It comes from a true story. So it was in the script, it was the name of the character, because I read in a, I don't know where, but I read somewhere that there was a story like that. This was the story of a migrant, I don't remember exactly where, but a migrant who found some monopoly bills, some monopoly bills in the garbage. And he brought this to the ghetto. He was so excited because I found so much money, and everybody around him laughed at him and said, "Hey, man, that's Monopoly." And after that, they gave him this name, Monopoly. You will be named Monopoly, and this was his surname. So I love this story, and so I gave the name Monopoly to the man who makes the false passports and everything and false bills.
Yeah. Well, I just think that it was almost like the undercurrent of the entire story. It was amazing because just as it happens in Africa, it's happening in Central and South America, where all of this illegal black market, there's a monopoly on the destiny of whoever's trying to cross borders. And so I thought it was very interesting that, you know, the background, I just saw it on the wall and I thought, oh, I think that's combated. Very good.
Thank you very, very much for attending. Thank you very much, Boris Lojkine, for traveling and joining us for the screening. Thank you, Bachir. Thank you, Marianne, for being here.